start off with. Thank you. All right, everyone, thank you for coming along this evening. It's great to see you along here at our drive-in again this evening. We're going to start off with number one in our wee hymn sheet. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. And going on to sing them lovely words about fasting alone in the desert. Tell of the days that he passed, how for our sins he was tempted. Yet was triumphant at last. Christ never sinned, but he took upon him the sins of the world for us. Thank you, Niall. Invite our singers up here. Thank you.
Most precious, sweetest love.
That's a lovely hymn to start off with. Tell us about the story of Jesus. What wonderful words in that. We'll just commit our time to the Lord in prayer. Our loving Father, we come to you again in Jesus' precious name. Our loving Father, we come and we praise you indeed for this world, indeed that you have made and you have created. God, as I've been away this couple of weeks, Lord, we've realised the beauty, the power, the majesty of God and everything that you've created. We see your handiwork all around, Lord, with mountains and rivers and valleys, God, and how we praise you that you are so mighty, you are so powerful, but yet you thought of us. And God, how we thank you for thinking of us. We thank you for sending your only begotten Son into this world to die on that old rugged cross. Not just to die, but to take upon him the sins of the world. Indeed, that us guilty, hell-deserving sinners could one day go and be with thee through the cross of our Saviour. Lord, how we thank you for saving us here this evening that know thee, Lord. But Lord, we realise there are ones within earshot here, Lord, that know not thee. And God, how we pray for them this evening, they'll understand indeed what you have done for them this evening, Lord. Open their eyes, Lord, we pray, Lord, and indeed that they'll understand indeed everything that you have done for them at Calvary. God, we thank you again indeed for your love for us, and we praise you again for this beautiful hymn that we've been singing about. Tell us of the cross where they nailed him, dying in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where they laid him, tell how he liveth again. We praise you that the cross couldn't hold you, the grave couldn't hold you, but indeed that up from the grave you arose with a mighty triumph over your foes. You arose a victor from the dark domain. You live forever with the saints to reign. God, how we praise you indeed for that home you are preparing for us in heaven. We read in John chapter 14, Lord, that you're going to prepare a place for us. And Lord, how we praise you indeed that you're preparing that place for us now. And when we look around us in this earth and we realise and see the beauty in it, Lord, we just cannot fathom the beauty of what heaven is going to be like in that place that you're preparing for us. So Lord, we pray indeed that you'll be one of our number here this evening. Bless us, we pray, Lord. Bless every car that has come in here, every person that is in the cars, Lord. We pray your hand will be upon everyone this evening, Lord. And indeed, Lord, that they'll know a sense of thy presence amongst us here this evening. Bless our brother George as he comes in a moment or two here to sing. Pray, Lord, that you'll just use the pieces you've laid upon his heart this evening. Pray again, too, for Pastor George as well as he brings thy word later on. Pray you'll minister through him and through thy word, we pray, Lord. Lord, just bless us this evening here, we pray, in thy name. Amen. As I was praying there, I was thanking the Lord for George Eggyer coming this evening, and we do thank him for coming along this evening. And just now, we're going to ask him to come and sing a couple of pieces to us here now. Thank you.
Lovely to be with you this evening and to share fellowship with you in this lovely new church building. You know, the weather's been that good, I don't think we'd even bother putting a roof on it. What do you think, George? That'll be all right. Don't bother. Great to be with you. Way back in the mid-1700s, off the northwest coast of Donegal, there was a raging storm out in the Atlantic. Also out there was a merchant vessel battling against that storm and losing the battle. The captain, John Newton, was in fear of his life. His ship was damaged and taking on water, and he thought that this was it. A hard man who dealt in selling human beings, and there he was on his knees. Somehow he managed to struggle into Lough Swilly, and as his ship was being repaired, we are told that not only did he had a near-death experience out there in the Atlantic, but also it made him focus on his fallibility and his need of eternal salvation. And we know that he talked about God and his amazing grace, God's unmerited favor. We believe he came to Jesus at that time. He wrote at least the words of this well-known hymn, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. The amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, there are a treasure house of promises that are ours in Christ through his resurrection. Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter 1, 3 and 4. Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you and for me. Isn't that good news? Yeah, it's good news. A living hope for those of us whose hope has faded, or perhaps we have lost hope this evening. There it is, because Jesus rose in victory from the grave. We too have living hope through what he accomplished at Calvary. There rose a lamb in Bethlehem. It was the third day since he died, and it was said he would arise then from the grave. This lamb came forth. Oh, I have reason to rejoice. He chose the place, he chose the hour, that he would rise by his own power, sacrificed 3 days ago. And now praise God, the Lamb rose. There rose a Lamb in Jerusalem. He was the Son of the great I Am. He proved to be my victory. Wasn't there to see him rise, but I was there when he saved my soul. For within my heart this Lamb rose. There rose a Lamb in Jerusalem. My victory. that the hymn writer of that wonderful... Sorry, do you want to sing about Cedar Hill?
You're doing better now.
Sorry, for 3 years now. And so we say with victory, because Christ rose from the dead, died on the cross for you and for me, and we say with that hymn writer of long ago, how great thou art.
How great thou art.
Thank you, George. And I really wasn't trying to butt in there. Don't worry. On with some announcements here. On Thursday evening, our own prayer meeting is at 8 p.m. And then next Lord's Day, our own brother George will be with us all next Sunday in the morning and in the evening again out here. Bill Dunn will be with us next Sunday evening out here. You'll enjoy Bill as well if you're able to make it along next Sunday evening as well. Turning to number two in our wee sheet, we'll leave out verse three, we'll sing verse one, two, and four, and ask our singers to get up along here and help me out, for I'm not just as good as George. And then the next George will come after we sing this piece. Two great Georges tonight, so there is. George's going to sing another couple, is he? One, yes. Two. You're going to sing another one, George. George is going to sing another one, and then we'll have another George. So two great Georges, but only great because God gave them a gift, and a mighty gift is that. Thank you. Verse number two.
A few years ago, there was a brief snippet on world news to say that a Japanese officer from the Second World War had died. And, well, there you go. These things happen. But the significance was that this particular Japanese soldier, he had a story to tell. Back in the war, his commander had sent him out to a remote island in the Pacific as an early warning station for the advancing enemy troops. And he loyally stayed there throughout the war. But when the war was over, information came to that effect, and he said, no, I don't accept that. And believe it or not, for something like 29 years, that man stayed in that remote island, refusing to accept that the Second World War was finished. How about that for stubbornness, eh? And then one day his commander came out in person, the man who had sent him out to the island originally, and he said to him, "Soldier, the war is over. The battle is over. Unfortunately, we lost, but the war's over." And so he accepted that from his commander, and he went back to his home in Japan. When I heard that introduction to this piece by Gloria Gaither, it struck me. And she related that to the fact that when Jesus hung on the cross and died for you and for me, he said, "It is finished. The battle is over." It was finished. It's done. But do we believe it? Or are we like that Japanese officer in the Second World War? Friends, it is finished this evening. Jesus has done it all for you and for me on the cross.
There's a line that's been drawn through the ages, and on that line stands the old rugged cross. On that cross, the battle is raging for the game of man's soul or his loss. On one side march the forces of evil, all the demons and devils of hell. And on the other, the angels of glory, and they meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict, and the sun refuses to shine. For there hangs God's Son in the balance, and then through the darkness he cries, "It is finished, the battle is over, it is finished. There'll be no more war. It is finished, the end of the conflict. It is finished, and Jesus is Lord." Yet in my heart, the battle was raging, not all prisoners of war had come home. These were battlefields of my own making. I didn't know that the war had been won. Then I heard that the King of all ages, oh, he had fought all life's battles for me, and that victory is mine for the claiming. And now praise his name, I am free. Oh, it is finished, the battle is over. It is finished, there'll be no more war. It's finished, the end of the conflict. For it is finished, and Jesus is Lord. It is finished, and
indeed, George, for your ministry and song tonight. What a blessing it has been, and what a blessing it always is when you come to minister in song. And tonight I want to just say what Alan has just said a few moments ago. Big welcome to you all this evening. We thank you for coming tonight and trust that you will be richly blessed as you gather here this evening. Watch out for us next Saturday. We're at the Mourne Esplanade. There's a big festival there called the GA Jive. We'll be there doing outreach. Please come over and see us. We'd be glad to have you and chat with you. So we'll be there next Saturday. If you have a copy of God's Word with you in the car, we're turning to Matthew's Gospel tonight for God's message in chapter number 8. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 8 tonight. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 8. The Lord Jesus Christ has just finished the great Sermon on the Mount. And in chapter number 8 and verse number 1 of Matthew's Gospel, we read, "When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus saith unto him, See thou tell no man, but go thy way and show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them." Amen. And ending there, we know that the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his own precious truth. It can be a very dark and a very difficult place to be. If you find yourself tonight in that place where you believe there is no hope, when you believe tonight, when you're in that dark, difficult place, when there seems to be no hope, I know tonight that life can be so difficult. Life can be so demanding. And what makes those times worse, in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our problems, in the midst of our perplexities, what makes it worse is when we believe that there seems to be no answer. So many people tonight believe that there's no hope for them, that there's no way out of this dark place. And tonight, something has put them there. Listen, it only takes tonight one phone call to turn your world upside down. It only takes one visit to the doctor tonight to make your life never to be the same again. Number of years ago, a lovely gentleman came into where I worked at this particular plumbing supplies. I thought he had came to buy some plumbing material, but when he reached the trade counter where I was, he wanted to speak to me personally. I brought him into the back store. This man I knew very well, a lovely man. With a trembling voice and with a trembling lip and with tears welling up in his eyes, I knew something bad was going to come. And he said to me, "George, I've got cancer. And there's no hope. And there's no cure. And the world that I have known has come to an end." You know, friend, it must be an awful moment to receive that news. And here's a man tonight in our Bible reading who was diagnosed with a disease that was called leprosy. What a moment it must have been for him when he was told that he had leprosy. Do you know what it meant for this man tonight? It meant that for this man he would be separated from family. He'd be separated from friends. He was cast out of the city. And that's what leprosy did in those days. If you were diagnosed with leprosy, you were cast out of the city, away from family, away from friends, and you were left to die alone. That's what leprosy did to this man. And this man in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8 tonight, is in this dark place where for him there seemed to be no hope. But there came a day when he found hope. There's an old saying, and I don't believe it's true because it has proved itself wrong too many times. People would say to me, "George, where there is life, there is hope. No matter what you face in life, where there is life, there is hope." I don't believe that tonight. Because life can soon be snuffed out like that. And where's hope? I was at a wake one night and my cousin's husband had died with cancer. And she says, as long as he was alive, we held on to that hope. But when he died, hope was gone. The truth is tonight, it's not where there is life, there is hope. Here's the truth tonight. Where there is Christ, there's hope. Because the Lord Jesus is the source of all hope. And in our Bible reading tonight, we have this man dying without hope, but he discovers hope. And that hope was discovered when he heard that Jesus Christ was passing by. Tonight, there's a worse disease than cancer. Tonight, there's a worse disease than leprosy. The Bible calls it sin. And one out of one is diagnosed with sin. And sin tonight, not only tonight, puts you out of separation from God, which is the worst condition that you can find yourself in tonight. Your sin tonight is driving you to a place called hell. But tonight there's hope for every sinner. And that hope is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to notice in our story tonight, I want you to watch the leper. This leper didn't need to be told that he was dying. This leper didn't have to be told he was hopeless. This leper didn't have to be told that he was a leper. But my friend, it's my duty tonight. It's my calling tonight. It's my responsibility to God tonight to remind you that you're a sinner. The Bible says we all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. And sin separates you from God tonight. And tonight, if you're a sinner, you're without hope. But tonight, there's hope tonight. There's hope in a person. And that person is the Lord Jesus. But watch this leper tonight. Watch this leper. When he hears that Jesus is passing by his way, I want you to notice how he came to the Lord Jesus. First of all, he came desperately. When he heard that the Lord Jesus was coming by, he came desperately. He came to the Lord Jesus because he knew that there was hope in him. He knew that Christ was the answer. Listen, dear, if you're suffering from the toothache, who do you go to? The butcher. You know, we had a dentist knocking a clay one time, and right enough, he should have been working for Tommy McCann instead of being a dentist. Tommy McCann was our local butcher. And if this man went to take your tooth out, he almost took your head off. It was desperate. But you know something tonight? If you're suffering from the toothache, who do you go to? You go to the dentist. If that car blows up or, well, stops working, you go to the mechanic. But my friend, there's one place you need to go to, and there's one person you need to go to tonight, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. This man came desperately. This man knew he was in a desperate condition. My dear unsaved friend, you're in a desperate condition tonight. You desperately need the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, friend, I want you to notice how he came. He came desperately, but he came worshiping. He didn't come with a list of complaints. He came worshiping. And I'll tell you why he came worshiping. Because he came knowing fine well that the Lord Jesus Christ was the answer. Because I believe this man heard the Lord Jesus preach this great Sermon on the Mount. And I believe he heard when the Lord Jesus preached. He heard those great words, "Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you." And I'm sure that when he heard the Lord Jesus preach these words, he says, "I'm going to try this. And I believe that the Master is my answer." And you know, friend, tonight the Lord Jesus Christ is your answer. He discovered. He came desperately tonight. He came desperately. But he came believing because he came to the Lord Jesus and he said, "Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean." It wasn't how this man felt made him come. It wasn't how this man was feeling. It was believing faith that brought him to the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. He that cometh to God must believe. Must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And this man came believing that he could be healed. And he came believing that he could be healed because he came believing that he needed to be healed. And my friend, you need to come to Christ believing tonight that you need to be saved. You need to come to Christ believing that you can be saved. Because tonight in your sin, you're perishing. Tonight you're sitting in your car. And tonight, friend, maybe listening to me, wherever you are, you can hear my voice. Tonight you're perishing without hope on the road to hell. But Christ is the source of all hope. I want to take you to a place called Calvary. And I want to take you to a foot of an old rugged blood-stained cross. Because upon the cross tonight, you will find the sinner's answer. And that answer is in the Lord Jesus Christ. The hymn writer says he took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own, and he bore that burden to Calvary, and he suffered, and he died alone. And tonight I ask you to behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. No religion can take away the sin of the world. No church can take away the sin of the world. The Lamb of God slain on Calvary's cross can take away the sin of the world. And there, through the shedding of his blood tonight, he paid the price that God demanded, and so that you and me could be set free, not only from the power of sin, but from the very penalty and the punishment of sin. He came desperately. He came desperately because he knew he was dying. He came desperately because he knew he had no hope anywhere else. He came desperately. You know, friend, the big problem is tonight so many people don't believe they're sinners. They don't believe they need to be saved. But the Bible makes it clear in 1 John 1:8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. He came desperately. I want you to notice in the story tonight, not only did he come desperately, but he was cured miraculously. In verse 3, it says, and Jesus put forth his hand and touched him and said, I will, be thou clean. And we read this, and immediately his leprosy was cleansed. I want you to notice now what the Lord Jesus does. The man came to the Lord Jesus, but let's watch what the Lord Jesus does. The Lord Jesus, first of all, puts out his hand and he touches the unclean leper. That was unheard of in those days. In those days, in Ulster language, you wouldn't have touched the poor leper with a barge pole. But the Lord Jesus went to the poor leper and he did the unbelievable. He did the unthinkable. He touched the unclean, filthy leper tonight. He touched the outcast. He touched the diseased. Nobody would have dared to touch him, but the Lord Jesus Christ loved him too much not to touch him. You know, friend, I see first of all the Savior's passion. This man tonight, who was dying and perhaps smelling with the filthiness of the rotten flesh, the Lord Jesus loved him enough to touch him. You know what that tells me tonight? The Lord Jesus loves everybody. The Lord Jesus loves you tonight. The Lord Jesus wasn't ashamed of this man. The Lord Jesus loved this man. When people would have ran from the leper, the Lord Jesus ran to the leper. The Lord Jesus comes to those that who are in great need. And tonight the Lord Jesus comes to you tonight because you're in great need. And the Lord Jesus Christ tonight comes to this dying leper. And I want you to notice the Savior's promise. It says there, Lord, if thou willst, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him and said, I will. I will. I'll make you clean. I'll make you whole. I'll get rid of the leprosy. I'll make life worth living again. I'll make your life different. I'll prove to people that I am the Son of God. And tonight, that's what the Lord Jesus wants to do for you tonight. He wants to make your life different. He wants to bring his hope into your life. He wants to bring life into your life. He wants to bring his peace. He wants to bring his power. He wants to bring himself tonight, himself into that life of yours. You know, friend, what the Lord Jesus wants to say tonight, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. The repenting sinner will always find room at Jesus' feet. And there the sinner will always find mercy. And there the sinners will always find grace. And there the sinner will always find forgiveness. The Lord Jesus Christ does what religion cannot do. And many are depending upon dead, empty religion. Jesus Christ does what religion cannot do. And Lord Jesus Christ is the one who can bring hope, who can bring joy and life and peace. And then I want you to notice the Savior's power that says, and immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Only Christ could cleanse the leper. Notice it was immediately. It wasn't half an hour or a day or two or a fortnight. Immediately. Tonight, friend, immediately, you could be saved. Immediately tonight. You could have your sins forgiven. Immediately tonight. You could be sure of heaven immediately tonight. But friend, you must come like this man, desperate in your sin tonight, desperate to be forgiven, desperate to be saved. This man didn't come dilly-dallying, he came desperate. And he came to the Lord Jesus and he was cured miraculously. Only Christ can cleanse the sinner, dear friend, through his precious blood. Mark chapter 2, verse 10, we say, the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sin. Let me say something tonight. A work of grace in a person's life is a miracle. The work of grace in any person's life is a miracle. And only the Lord Jesus can do it. A number of years ago, back in 2011, September 2011, I conducted a gospel mission in Banbridge Independent Methodist Church. And a lady came to speak to me after that meeting. And this lady, she wasn't a young lady, middle-aged lady. And she had an awful problem. She had an awful problem with drugs. They were prescribed drugs. She couldn't live without them. Her life was dark. Her life was difficult. And she came to me that night and she says, can you help me? I says, I'm sorry, love, but I can't. But I can point you to one who can. She poured out her heart and she felt that life wasn't worth living. And I says, listen, life is worth the living no matter what you're going through because he lives. And from the word of God, we counseled her and we talked to her about the Lord Jesus. Before we left that little vestry, both her and I got onto our knees. And had the joy of leading her to the Lord. And I remember the next night, I happened to speak to her again. How are you? She says, you know, my life's different. She says, what about the tablets? The tablets are all, they're all down the toilet and they're gone forever. Do you know today, that lady is a Sunday school teacher in that church. That's the change that Jesus brought into her life. And that's the change Jesus can bring into your life tonight. Jesus done something for this man that he can do for you tonight. You've got something worse than leprosy. You've got sin tonight. And sin tonight will bring your never-dying soul on that final moment to hell. But God so loves you tonight that he gave his only begotten Son But whosoever believes in him, and it doesn't matter what religion you come from or what background, religion background you have, doesn't matter, that doesn't count with God. Whosoever believeth on him shall have everlasting life. And thank God you can have everlasting life tonight before you leave here. But you do need to be saved. And you do need Christ tonight. I often think of this man, if he could sing, what would be his testimony song? I think it would have to be this one. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me. And he made me whole. And here we have a man tonight who came desperately because he knew what he was and he knew who he was. And he knew that where Christ was, there was hope. When there was hope, nowhere else. He found hope. And he found life. And he found joy. And he found the reason for living was in the Lord Jesus Christ. And tonight our closing hymn, as we are going to sing it together, is a wonderful hymn. You could make it your prayer tonight without any reservation. Out of my bondage, sorrow and night, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Into thy freedom, gladness and light, Jesus, I come to thee. Tonight, this man's experience can be your experience tonight. But whatever you do, don't miss it. The Lord Jesus Christ is still the answer. And he's still tonight. He's still this day the sinner's hope. And he's still your hope. So come to him. Let him save you. Let him change your life. Let him fill you with his Spirit. And he will give you the power to become a child of God here and now. May God bless you. Let's pray. O God, our Father, tonight we thank you for the lovely Lord Jesus Christ tonight, who is the source of all hope. And tonight there's many people, Lord, we know tonight, and maybe some here, and they seem to have no hope. But Lord, tonight we know that Jesus Christ is the source of all hope tonight. And we ask thee and we plead with thee that, Lord, for any tonight who's here and they're struggling in their sin and they're struggling with life, Lord, come to where they are the way you came to the sinner. And Lord, do a work of grace that only thou canst do. And thou art able to do it, Lord. And we just pray earnestly. Give deciding grace tonight. May the power of God, the Holy Spirit, do that work that will only count for eternity. It's through the precious name of the Lord Jesus we pray. Amen. We're going to sing that hymn together. Out of my bondage, sorrow and night, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Into thy freedom, gladness and light, Jesus, I come to thee. Let's take a moment as we sing these words tonight. Let's think of them as we sing them, because the Lord Jesus really does make a difference. He really makes life worth living. And when all hope seems to be gone, you'll find hope tonight in the Lord Jesus. There's nobody like him. Nobody like him. And I trust you'll find that out for yourself this evening. Let's think of the words as we sing them. Thank you.
Jesus, I come.
Why don't you come tonight? Come from that life of bondage into a life of blessing that only Jesus can give. And tonight, if you do would like and would want to speak to me, please feel free now. Please do feel free to wait behind. Or turn in your car if you're on your way home. Not the first time that has happened. Return here and I'll be here. And I'll talk with you and help you with anything that's on your heart. It's not me you need tonight, it's the Lord Jesus. And please don't be afraid. The Lord Jesus tonight calls you and you come. Let's pray together. Lord, tonight we believe you have been really speaking this evening in song tonight, Lord, and in word. We can almost feel tonight, Lord, that real, and we do feel tonight, Lord, that real sense of God. And Lord, you know the heart that you've been speaking to, and you know the hearts tonight that's yearning for peace and yearning for hope and yearning for healing, yearning for life tonight. And I pray that you will give deciding grace to those people tonight. That in years to come, many will look to this blockyard and say, it was there where I met Jesus. It was there where I started off for heaven. It was there where I got real life, new life. And it was there I found real hope. And so, Lord, as we leave tonight, we just pray that thou wilt guard every word that thou hast spoken. And pray, Lord, tonight that your Holy Spirit will do that which no other can do. Because we do confess tonight, salvation is of the Lord. Impart us now, Lord, in thy fear, and with thy blessing take us to our homes in safety. We pray in our Saviour's lovely name. Amen. Now, friend, tonight, if I have said, if anybody would like to come and speak to me, please feel free to do so. We'll talk to you confidentially. We'll talk to you privately. But please come and speak to us if we can be of any help. For nobody knows, nobody, this could be the last opportunity that you may have. God's calling you tonight. Don't go. Come to him who alone can give you eternal life. God bless you tonight. Do remember us, we're back here again, same time next week. Bill Dunn will be along. You'll enjoy him. He's an ex-backing vocalist for Van Morrison. And you will really enjoy his ministry and song. So friends, God bless tonight. And safe home. And God be with you till we do meet again. Thank you. Amen.